TAG TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. People in Pakistan's largest and the resource-rich province of Balochistan are enduring an endless state-sponsored oppression. The locals, who refer to Pakistan's administration in the region as colonial subjugation, have for years been running pillar to post seeking help in getting them freedom. Recently, a group of Baloch activists held a demonstration outside the United Nations in Geneva on the sidelines of the 43rd session of UNHRC. They accused Islamabad of being an occupier, plunderer and a human rights violator. A report.
This group of men and women in Swiss city of Geneva is representing hundreds of thousands of persecuted Balochs in Pakistan. The floats and banners reading, Balochistan is bleeding, Free Balochistan and stop enforced disappearances speak volume about Pakistan's stepped up efforts of eliminating the Baloch ethnicity. A number of similar events have been organized by exiled Baloch leaders and activists on the sidelines of the ongoing United Nations Human Rights Council session that aim to expose Pakistani atrocities in Balochistan and its hypocrisy at international platforms. Munir Mengal, the president of Baloch Voice Association, is disappointed with the little attention their movement has received from international community and seeks an immediate UN intervention.
The people inside Baloch are being eliminated. We are receiving reports. We are receiving the data which shows that the Pakistani state is eliminating Baloch. Approximately, 8 to 10 people are being victim of enforced disappearances per week. Approximately 3 to 4 people are being killed by the Pakistani state forces. Only of those who were kidnapped, who are victim of enforced disappearances.
Balochistan has huge gas and mineral reserves and contributes a large share to Pakistan's revenue, but does not receive corresponding appreciation in return. Those who dissent or demand their rights are systematically targeted by state forces. Government takes extrajudicial measures to stifle their voices. They are subject to police high-handedness and imprisoned incommunicado. In past few years alone, hundreds of locals have been killed and thousands others have vanished without a trace. Activists accuse army of attacking and violating women in order to rein in the dissenting men of the region. They even accuse army of trading their organs after killing them.
They are using rape as a tool of oppression. They are taking our women, they are torturing our women, and Baloch women are very, very, all women are honorable, but you know, the tribal kind of women, the women who are not in mainstream, who have never seen these army people. They just come, they burn our houses, and they grab our women, they grab our kids, just to take their organs out. They're selling organs of Baloch people. It's hell that's going on there. 40 million Baloch, they are just in concentration of Pakistan and Iran also. So this is the This is the time that United Nations should understand and United Nations should feel their responsibility to come to Balochistan and intervene.
Baloch activists have made repeated pleas before the world. They want international community to take note of the massive human rights violations being carried out at the commands of Pakistan Army. Over the years, they have lodged several complaints with the United Nations and have held various protests around different cities of the world. But all their requests and petitions have fallen on deaf ears of international community, as no action, not even a statement of condemnation, has been issued from any state or organization. A poor Baloch has nowhere to go today, as plights are mounting and hopes are diminishing. An absence of an international response has confirmed to the looming catastrophe, which he is in no position to escape.
To know more on the issue, we have Mr. Hakim Baloch, the leader of Baloch National Movement, with us. So, Mr. Baloch, could you tell the real human rights situation in the resource-rich province of Balochistan?
For the people of Balochistan, it's not part of Pakistan anyway. It is the occupied land, which was forcefully occupied. That's the one thing. And when we talk about the human rights situation, I think the month of January, which the report have come from Balochistan, it says 42 people were abducted and 12 of them were killed. And these reports are not coming from any political party, but from the human rights organization, which are working tirelessly in Balochistan, even though they are affected. The ex-information secretary of Baloch Human Rights Organization is missing for more than 3 years. Rashid Hussain Baloch, a human rights activist, he was just raising voice for the missing people. He was asking for the safe release of them. He was in UAE and he was abducted on behest of Pakistan Army. And now he's in torture cell for more than 1 year. This is the situation which people are facing. And if we talk about the areas where no one can access, maybe not even the political parties because of the military power and the aggression, those kinds of areas, they are facing worse form of brutality.
What sort of movements are being run by the Baloch people and activists? What all are they fighting for?
You see, the situation in Balochistan, they made it in a way that people should not speak. I'll give you an example. Let's say in India nowadays, there are protests in New Delhi and everywhere. But you see, there are voices. They are against government and they are supportive voices of government. But people have right to talk. In Pakistan, they don't have the right to talk. They don't have the right to protest. They know what they are suffering. They know what they are facing. They know how they have to deal with it. But when it's come to the idea, when it's come for them to talk, the army don't allow them to talk. It is someone maybe who is more lucky than the one remaining back home. We can speak. But yes, the people, they know their rights. The people, they're not happy. They are angry. For time being, maybe they are scared or they are thinking of another political way, but they are not happy. And I'll give you an example of this by saying that in past week they have abducted Baloch students, the female Baloch students and the male Baloch students, only because they were asking the student rights. They were protesting to restore their universities, some of the facilities which were taken away from them. And for these reasons, they were arrested, the boys student, they were tortured. And this is the situation in which people have no right to talk. So that's why many people, you don't hear from Balochistan directly talking about this. But yes, they know what they are asking and what we are struggling for them in here.
Moving on. The president of island nation of Sri Lanka, Gotabaya Rajapaksa, has dissolved country's parliament and has called for fresh elections in April. While the supporters and the members of his party hailed the decision as appropriate in nation's interest, the opposition has cried foul and has blamed his government's incompetence as the prime reason behind the announcement. A report.
Six months before its term gets completed, the Sri Lankan parliament has been dissolved by President Gotabaya Rajapaksa. President used his constitutional powers to push fresh elections in the country that has suffered both economic and political setbacks in recent past. Rajapaksa said that the presidency will reclaim most of the executive powers that had been clipped through an amendment by former Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe. The 225 seats of the parliament will go to polls next month and the elected members will meet in May. Supporters have called it an intelligent decision, citing the country is going through political and economic turmoil.
ගරු ජනාධිපතිතුමා ගෝඨාභය රාජපක්ෂ ගත්ත හොඳම තීරණය තමයි පාර්ලිමේන්තුව විසිරූප එක. නිසි කාලට නිසි විදියට වැසි වස්සනවා වගේ රටේ දියුණුව වෙනුවෙන් මේ ගත්ත තීරණය ගැන වෙනුරපේරා ජනතාවට කියනවා මේක බුද්ධිමත් තීරණයක්. ජනතාව සූදානම් වෙන්න බුද්ධිමත්ව හිතලා බුද්ධිමත්ව නායකයෝ පත් කරගන්න කිසිම පක්ෂයකට කඩේ නොගී.
ආණ්ඩු විසහාරපියකත් හරි. හරියට හරි එක. අපි කළ යුතුයි. අපිට දෙන්න ඕනේ සම්මේව එකක්. අපි මොනවද කරන්නේ අපි තව අලුත් කෙනෙක් පත් කරගන්නවද අරගලම් පත් කරගන්නද කියන එක අපිට මහ ජනතාවට දෙන්න ඕනේ ඒගොල්ලෝ ඉඩක් ඒගොල්ලන්ට ඕනේ දේ වැඩ කරන්න බෑ අපිට ඕනේ දේ ඒගොල්ලෝ වැඩ කරන්න ඕනේ
Ever since he became president, Rajapaksa has been running a minority government with his brother Mahinda holding the chair of prime minister. The government requires absolute majority in the house to push its legislative plans and agendas. The Rajapaksa brothers are in fact need of two-third majority to make any constitutional amendment which they have long been seeking. The opposition, however, has criticized the move, saying it was a violation of the democratic nature of the Sri Lankan parliament.
Tamasahayak apita nilakali thiyena. Gotabaya Rajapaksa mahathaya kemathi naha me aanduwa tawa tawa එක මාසයක්වත් ඉස්සරහට යන්න කැමති නැහැ. මොකද මේ පාලනය කරපු මාස 3ක කාල සීමාව තුළ ආණ්ඩුවේ නිර්වත බරපතල විදිහට හෙල්ලුම් කෑවා දෙදරුවා.
Fresh elections will provide Rajapaksa brothers with an opportunity to set the tone for domestic, diplomatic and economic future of the country. While the sagging economy has been the country's major worry lately, a robust security policy and resisting the influence of other countries on the island is going to be key objectives of the next parliament.
Moving on, the political situation in Afghanistan is deteriorating. While on one side, despite country's election commission declaring Ashraf Ghani the winner, the opposition, primarily Abdullah Abdullah, is not just ready to accept the verdict. On other, the Taliban have refused to play by the rule book of the historic peace deal. They are demanding the release of 5,000 prisoners before making advancements on the second step of the peace deal. A report.
Abdullah Abdullah, the chief executive of war-torn state of Afghanistan, who has been defeated comprehensively as per the Independent Election Commission of Afghanistan, has threatened to hold a parallel inauguration next week. In an interview given to a private news channel, Abdullah said that he was ready to resolve the crisis through negotiations, but he would be forced to take alternate steps if they don't work out. The statement comes after the election body of the state has refused to entertain his allegations of fraud. After months of deliberations and recounting, the commission had declared Ashraf Ghani the winner of the September presidential polls. But the executive of the state, who had secured his position last time in similar fashion, has not accepted it. He has used social media and public platforms to express his anger and allege government of committing fraud. In such a scenario, the political situation, which was just appearing to return on track once again, is staring at a major roadblock. On the other side, the commitments inked in the peace deal have brazenly been violated by the insurgents, as scores of deadly attacks have been reported around the country in just 1 week. People in Washington say they expected such violence, but have asked the Taliban to stay committed to the deal.
The signing of the U.S.-Taliban agreement in Doha, together with the realization of the U.S.-Afghan joint declaration in Kabul, laid the groundwork for the road ahead toward a lasting peace in Afghanistan. We know that the road ahead will be difficult. We expected it. We were right. The upsurge in violence in parts of Afghanistan over the last couple days is unacceptable. In no uncertain terms, violence must be reduced immediately for the peace process to move forward.
After signing of the historic peace deal on 29th of February, the stakeholders have come up with conflicting positions on the manner in which the second step of the peace process, the intra-Afghan dialogue, must be followed. While the Taliban had earlier agreed to all points in the deal, they have asked the government to release 5,000 prisoners as a precondition to any intra-Afghan talks. Ghani administration has turned down the proposal in clear terms. This has once again created a usual situation of impasse. So the state, which was mired down in war for almost 2 decades, has still not found a clear road. While political situation is being held hostage by a chief executive, Taliban is unwilling to give up on its demands. Now it would be extremely daunting for both Washington and Kabul to choose a way to bring peace back to the state.
Moving on. The week when the entire world is celebrating women, we bring you a story of courage and determination from the Conservative Society of Pakistan, where the gender has not been given the respect and space it deserves. Female boxer Shehnaz Kamal has not just punched above her weight, but is inspiring and grooming many others to achieve their aspirations. Have a look.
Wearing her sparring mitts, Shehnaz Kamal is getting ready for a rigorous coaching session. One after the other, she ensures that every boxer swings, punches, and trains with her. The male-dominated sport and the Conservative Society of Pakistan has not been able to deter this Peshawar-born lady who has gone on to make a mark in the boxing arena.
मैं पाकिस्तान की वाहिद खातून हूं जो बॉक्सिंग सिखाती हूं और पेशावर से मेरा ताल्लुक है पेशावर के एक टिपिकल गांव में मैं रहती हूं और उसके बावजूद भी मैं बॉक्सिंग में आगे आई हूं पाकिस्तान की 3-star इंटरनेशनल 1-star कोच हूं
शी इज द फर्स्ट एंड ओनली इंटरनेशनल फीमेल बॉक्सिंग कोच रजिस्टर्ड विद द बॉक्सिंग फेडरेशन ऑफ पाकिस्तान एंड शी इज डूइंग हर बेस्ट टू नर्चर अ यंगर जनरेशन ऑफ बॉक्सर्स Despite growing up in a family of boxers, Kamal knew her boxing aspirations were mere fantasy in a society that deemed women participating in public events as demeaning. However, she continued pursuing boxing secretly. She became optimistic only after she married a boxer. When her husband discovered her interest, he started coaching her, breaking with social norms of Pathans, the ethnic group they belong to. Few years later, she even started training her children on the rooftop of her house in 2008.
پھر میری بیٹی بھی پھر وہ ہو گئی پیدا ہو گئی پھر میں نے سوچا کہ اگر کوئی اور نہیں ہے تو میں اپنی بیٹی کو باکسر بنا دوں تو میری بیٹی کے لیے پھر ظاہر ہے ایک فیمیل کوچ بھی ہونی چاہیے تو میں نے اس نیت سے جو ہے پاکستان کے لیے یعنی کہ بس یوں سمجھے کہ اب میں نے پٹھان معاشرے کو چیر پار کے میں آگے چلا گیا اور اپنی وائف کو اس میں لے آیا باکسنگ میں مجھے کوئی اعتراض نہیں ہے
کمال ہیز تھری ڈاٹرز اینڈ اے سن اینڈ از کین فار ہر چلڈرن ٹو ٹیک آن دی اسپورٹ ون آف ہر ڈاٹرز ہادیہ کمال ایون وان اے میڈل ایٹ انٹر پروونشل گیمز ٹیسٹیفائنگ ہر مدرز کریڈینشلز ایٹ کوچنگ Kamal is happy with what she has achieved today, but the journey has not been a fairy tale.
مخالفت تو میری بہت زیادہ جگہوں پہ ہوئی ہے ان لاز نے بھی کی ہے فیملی نے بھی کی ہے ریلیٹیوز جتنے بھی تھے سب نے کی ہے کسی نے ساتھ نہیں دیا سوائے ہسبینڈ کے ہسبینڈ نے ساتھ دیا لیکن جب ایک مقام پہ پہنچ گئی نیشنل کوچ کے علاوہ جب انٹرنیشنل ہو گئی تو پھر سارے واہ واہ کرنے لگے اس سے پہلے کافی مشکلات کا سامنا کرنا پڑا ہر جگہ پہ ایون کہ مجھے اپنا گاؤں بھی چھوڑنا پڑا
ٹل ٹوڈے Kamal has trained around 600 male and 150 female boxers. She says there would be more if there were government support.
Moving on. India is well known for its culture and festivities where every season brings celebrations along with it. One such festival is Holi, which is celebrated on the onset of spring. Today, we'll show you how different pre-Holi celebrations, including Laddubar and Latmar Holi, have become an essential part of the festivity. A report.
Hindu devotees were drenched in colors as they celebrated Laddubar Holi, a celebration that heralds the arrival of Holi, the festival of colors. The flung laddus are pocketed with reference as blessed offerings and hence the name Laddu Holi.
Aaj Laddu Holi aur yahan ka anand bilkul alag hai sari duniya mein kai jagah pe festival hote hain lekin yahan par jo apnapan milta hai wo kahin nahi Holi re rasiya
jeevanaj mein Like every year, this year too, people in the Barsana city of India's Uttar Pradesh celebrated Latmar Holi with full enthusiasm and gaiety. Celebrating an age-old tradition, men from neighboring towns and villages come to Barsana and sing provocative songs to invite the attention of women. The women go on the offensive and use long staves called lathis to beat up the men folk who protect themselves with shields. This particular sequence gives Barsana's Holi festival the appellation of Latmar or hitting with staves.
برسانے نند گاؤں کے بھوریاروں پہ لاٹیاں برسائیں گی برسا رہے پوری تیاری ہو گئی آپ دیکھیں یہ سوبھاگیہ ساری لاٹیاں کھانے کے لیے ہوریارے اتسک ہیں آپ ہم سب لوگ اس کا آنند لے رہے ہیں
ڈیورنگ دا فیسٹیول ا مود آف جوبیلیشن فیلز دی ایئر دا فیسٹیول آف ہولی انگلفز ایوری بڈی ان اٹس ایگزیوبرنس People put colors on each other, distribute sweets, and take out processions, dancing to drums in a melange of colors. It is believed that the spirit of Holi encourages the feeling of brotherhood in the society, and even enemies become friends on this day, strengthening the social fabric of the country.
Holi is an important festival of the Hindus which is celebrated with great enthusiasm and fervor. People forget their troubles and indulge in this festival to celebrate brotherhood. On that colorful note, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.